teach us how to pray. Teach us what to say. Teach us how to love. Oh, my Lord, teach us how to pray. As we come to worship, come to praise your name. Forgive us our trespasses, oh my Lord, teach us how to pray. Teach us how to pray. Teach us what to say. Teach us how to love. Oh, my Lord, teach us how to pray.
Welcome, everybody, to workshop number 101 with Ronald Rolheiser. My name is Dominic Nears, and I work for the Office of Religious Education in Los Angeles as the coordinator of adult faith formation. So please silence your cell phones and let us all take a moment to silence ourselves for prayer. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. O God of loving kindness, open our eyes and ears to the needs of all. Give us your Spirit that we may be an instrument of your peace and justice. Bless all who gather here this weekend with your wisdom. We ask this in Jesus' holy name. Amen. It is my honor and pleasure to introduce Father Ronald Rolheiser. He is a Roman Catholic priest and a member of the Missionary Oblates of Mary Immaculate. He has taught theology and philosophy at Newman Theological College in Edmonton, Alberta, and served as provincial superior of his Oblate province and on the General Council of the Oblates in Rome. Currently, Ronald Rolheiser is the president of the Oblate School of Theology in San Antonio, Texas. So as a Canadian, he's essentially in exile there. And this is also the name of his weekly column, which is carried by more than 80 newspapers worldwide, including the Tidings in LA. And from your reaction, I can tell that many of you read his column. If you don't get his column on the kitchen table every week, then you must know him from his many inspirational books that are popular throughout the English-speaking world and beyond. His most recent publications are Sacred Fire, A Vision for a Deeper Human and Christian Maturity from 2004, and The Passion and the Cross from 2015. So please welcome Father Ronald Rolheiser.
Thank you, Dominic. And my first question, can everybody hear the arena? No? Okay. Little story told, but first of all, it's wonderful to be here, and I thank you all for coming. Little story they tell about Lyndon Johnson when he was president of the United States. And he was introduced once on a stage, and he was introduced in a rather flattering way. And when he was finished, he thanked the MC, and he said, "I want to thank you for this introduction." He said, "I'm only sorry that two people can't be here to hear it." He says, "My father and my mother." He said, "Because my father would have liked it, and my mother would have believed it." Okay. I want to talk to you this morning about moral loneliness. It's an interesting combination of words, moral loneliness. And I want to do three things with you. I want to talk a little bit about loneliness in our lives in general, and highlight a particular kind of loneliness, that term I stole from Robert Coles, that's called moral loneliness. And then I want to define, what is moral loneliness? And especially, where does it come from? Why do we experience this in our lives? And then lastly, to talk a little bit about what do we do with it? But just to set a little stage, I want to read you two little pieces, almost like gathering hymns for this. And the first one is from Hafiz, the Persian poet of many centuries ago, and his little poem on loneliness. Hafiz says, "Don't surrender your loneliness quickly. Let it cut you deeply. Let it ferment and seize in you, as few human or even divine things can do to you. Loneliness. There is something missing in my heart tonight, but it has made my eyes soft and my voice tender. It has made me feel my need for God absolutely and clearly." Second piece I want to read is from the Song of Songs. And as you know, the Song of Songs is written in a feminine voice. It's a woman who is seeking her soulmate and then finds her soulmate. See, the subtitle of this talk is "The Deeper Reality Beneath Our Longing for a Soulmate." So this is from the Song of Songs. This woman writes, "On my bed, I sought my beloved. I sought him, but could not find him. So I got up and went through the city, in the streets and in the squares, seeking my beloved. I sought him, but I could not find him. One day, I came upon the watchman on his rounds in the city, and I asked him, 'Have you seen my beloved?' Barely had I passed him when I found him. I found my beloved, and when I found him, I caught him. And I would not let him go until I brought him to my mother's house, into the room and to the bed where my mother conceived me." Now, you can't write more intimate language than that. He said, "I looked for my soulmate, and when I found him," he said, "I caught him and I took him to my mother's room, to my mother's bedroom, to the bed where my mother conceived me." What is a soulmate? What is loneliness? What is moral loneliness? I want to start by looking at loneliness in general. You know, when we look at our lives and we look at our experience, we see that the very center of all of our experience, no matter how good your life is, no matter how much intimacy and love and creativity and family we have in our lives, you know, there's always a certain lack. There's a certain appetitiveness. There's a certain desire. There's some kind of aching. There's an incompleteness that doesn't go away. And it's interesting when you examine this incompleteness, it lies, as I said, at the center of our lives, not at the periphery. I'll tell you what I mean by that. Henry Nouwen used to write eloquently on this. And Henry Nouwen used to say, you know, we aren't people who live in habitual intimacy who sometimes get lonely. We're lonely people who occasionally find intimacy. He said, we're not people who live in a restful condition habitually and then sometimes get restless. We're restless people who sometimes find rest. And we're not people who live in habitual solitude, serenity, who sometimes experience disquiet in our lives. We live in a perpetual disquiet, and we sometimes find solitude. But notice where the default is. The default is we're always somehow aching, somehow missing something. Now, how do we cope with that? You know, what would we do with loneliness in our lives, whether we admit it or are consciously aware of it or not? What do we do with it? Well, there's two ways. More superficially, and more just at the level of instinct. Our instinctual, you know, we're wired for health, and our body and our minds want to be healthy, and they don't like restlessness. So we instinctually, we try to assuage that through achievement, to be successful, through affluence, through comfort, through sex, through trying to somehow make ourselves immortal in this life. You've all heard that expression where they say, plant a tree, write a book, have a child. It's an interesting expression. Plant a tree, write a book, have a child. Why? Because then you've somehow left a mark. You've left something permanent on this planet, and you can't be erased. That's our deep instinctual, and it's healthy. That's a healthy feeling. It's inside of us, but it comes from the loneliness in our lives. But that's more superficially, more deeply, at least if we have some type of good self-awareness and spirituality, we try to solve this through love, through family, through faith, through meaning, through religion. And partially that works. To the extent that we have love, family, community, faith, religion in our lives, to a certain extent, it takes away, it fills in. You say, yeah, my life is complete. This is a good life. But at the same time, even when we say it's a good life, I have a good family, I'm confident in my faith, I like my church, so on. Even when you say that, there's still something missing, something beneath. There's something that can't be fully quenched. Now, it's interesting, when you look through just literature, whether it's philosophy, literature, anthropology, poetry, I just read you some of it, scripture, you'll find that there's many, many wonderful expressions of that, that kind of, in a capsule, nail it. So for instance, we're all familiar with St. Augustine's famous line in which he opens his confessions. St. Augustine said, "You've made us for yourself, Lord, and our hearts are restless until they rest in you." That kind of nails it. See, God has made us for God. God has put infinity into us. And so when we're inside the finite, which is our body, our lives, there'll always be a restlessness until finally we rest in God. You've made us for yourself, Lord. Our hearts are restless until they rest in you. Now, if you go into scripture, I like this wonderful expression in the book of Koheleth, oftentimes in English Bibles as the book of Ecclesiastes. And it's a famous text that you all know by heart. And that's Koheleth. You know, the word Koheleth or Ecclesiastes means preacher, the preacher. The preacher says, if you were outside the arena this morning, there is a preacher out there. You know, and as much as I'm not so turned on by his message, you have to admire this guy. He has been hollering since 7 o'clock this morning, nonstop. I think Jesus is pleased with him. Okay. But the preacher says this famous text about there is a season. We know that text by heart, and singers sing it. There's a season for everything, a time to be born, a time to die, a time to live, time to grow, a time for planting, a time for harvest. And this person sets these wonderful 14 opposites. There's a time to hate, a time to love. And then he ends this, and we often stop reading this too soon. He said, and there's a time for war and a time for peace. And then he's going to make his point. He says, God has made everything beautiful in its own time, but God has put timelessness into the human heart. So the human heart is out of sync with everything from beginning to end. It's interesting. He says, God has made this beautiful rhythm of the seasons. Spring, summer, winter, fall, you know, babies are born and they grow up and then they have babies and the cycle of life goes on. He said, there's a beautiful cycle and there's a beautiful rhythm to all of life and nature, except, he said, you have a certain something in your heart. He calls it timelessness. He said, that sets you out of sync from beginning to end. Animals can be content. Human beings are rarely content. I was told my students, you know, the difference between humans and animals is this. Cattle contentedly munch grass in pastures, and humans discontentedly smoke grass in bars. Okay. Because animals don't have timelessness in their hearts. Or I love an expression from Karl Rahner, the German theologian, and Rahner can be so brilliant and so abstract all at the same time. So this is just Rahner's brilliance and his abstractness. I want to read you a caption from him. Great line. Rahner says, in the torment of the insufficiency of everything attainable, we learn that here in this life there is no finished symphony. What a line. In the torment of the insufficiency of everything attainable, we learn that here in this life there is no finished symphony. You never get there. There's somehow, it's beautiful, but there's no finished symphony. Henry Nouwen used to say, in this life there's no such a thing as a clear-cut, pure joy. It's quite an expression. Now, let me give you two images here. Ruth Burrows, the British Carmelite, some years ago, did a photographic study of Thérèse of Lisieux, the little flower. As you know, Thérèse of Lisieux just lived at the end of the 19th century, and cameras were already working, and her sister Celine was a photographer. So we have hundreds of pictures of the little flower, photographs, in groups, by herself, doing this. Her sister was a photographer. We have all these pictures. So Ruth Burrows, the British Carmelite, studied those pictures and said, you know, something interesting, and you can do this by yourself. Find books, pictorial books of Thérèse of Lisieux, and check this out. She said, here's this saint, this mystic, said, but there's always a quality about her of being alone. Even when Thérèse of Lisieux is in a group picture, she's somehow deeply alone. There was a quality of aloneness to her. That here's this person with this great heart who reaches out, who's so communitarian, and yet there's something deeply alone in her all the time. And you see it in the pictures. You look at a group picture, and here's Thérèse with her community, but she's somehow alone. And then Robert Coles from Harvard some years ago wrote a book on Simone Weil. And he said there's something about her and her writings and her person. And as you know, she was this powerful, one of the first feminists who ever walked this planet, powerful moral woman who died really giving her life away in the Second World War. He said, but in her writings and her person, there was always a deep aloneness. There's something about her that was, she was always unanimity minus one. And he put a word to it. It's the word I'm using this morning. He said, she had a deep moral loneliness. She suffered from moral loneliness. Now, we're going to work that term. What is moral loneliness? You know, I wrote a book when I was still a young man on loneliness. And at that time, I said there's four kinds of loneliness. I said, you know, the loneliness of alienation. There's the loneliness of restlessness. There's the loneliness of rootlessness, which is powerful in our world today. And there's also just the loneliness of psychological depression. If I wrote the book today, I'd add a fifth kind. But the deepest loneliness of all is moral loneliness. Now, what is moral loneliness? Today, too often, in our culture, oftentimes this is simply seen and written off as sexual desire. So that today, oftentimes, people say that loneliness is cured by what? By romantic sexuality. If you have the right sexual partner, that's the panacea for loneliness. Now, it's interesting. Don't write that off too quickly, you know. There's a deep kernel of truth in this. Remember when you go back to the first pages of Scripture, and when God made Eve from Adam, that's an archetypal image. However, the first Adam and Eve, and Adam opens his eyes and he said, at last, bone from my bone, flesh from my flesh. And Scripture said that's why a person leaves his father and his mother and his family And the woman leaves her family, and the two cling to each other, and the two become one flesh. See, so that biblical answer to human loneliness is the one flesh union of husband and wife, of male and female coming together. So there's a kernel of truth in that, because Scripture says it's not good for the man to be alone. They weren't just talking about Adam, they were talking about every person, man, woman, child, forever. But that's too simple. Like I said, there's a kernel of truth, but also experience, and experience here is really clear. Experience shows that sexual union alone is no guarantee of overcoming separateness. Sexual intimacy, even if you have great intimacy with your partner, doesn't fully overcome loneliness. The same as Thérèse of Lisieux, her mystical union, even with God, didn't somehow overcome this loneliness on this planet. You know, people are right on this. They say, you know what's worse than sleeping alone? Sleeping alone when you're not sleeping alone. That's worse than sleeping alone. Sexual union, it's mandated by God as the cure to loneliness, but it doesn't take away our moral loneliness. Why? It's interesting. Scripture has some really interesting images here. And again, they're archetypal. You want to read sometime, just go and pick up the book of Judges, chapter 11. And there's a story in there of a king. I can't pronounce his name. But it's on the surface, it's just a horrible story, but with deep archetypal implications. So this is the story. They say there was this king, Jewish king. He's at war, and he's losing. So he makes this vow to God. He said, if you let me win this war, I'll sacrifice the first person I meet when I get back to my kingdom. That's nice. So God lets him win the war. That's the way these stories work. When he comes back to his kingdom, the first person he meets is his daughter, who's just in the bloom of youth. And now he's saddened. He tells his daughter, this is terrible. He said, like, I made this vow to God and so on, and I won't do it. And she said, no, you can do it. He said, I'll die on the altar of sacrifice, but there's one thing. See, in great archetypal literature, there's always one thing. And the one thing is, says, now I'm going to die a virgin. I'm going to die inconsummate. I'll never know a man. I'll never have children. So my life will be incomplete. So I need to mourn this. So she says, I need to have 40 days to go to the desert with my maiden companions. And there's an incredible expression. She says, I need to bewail my virginity. And so he lets her go, and she goes to the desert for 40 days, and they howl and so on that she's going to die a virgin. She comes back and dies on the altar of sacrifice. Now, on the surface, that's a bad story. Okay. But this is archetypal. You know how in movies they have disclaimers today saying, no real horses died in this movie? Okay. In Scripture, with a lot of these difficult texts, no real people die in these stories. Okay. So don't take it literally. It's horrible if you take it literally. If you take it metaphorically, it's a powerful, beautiful story. Because it's not just somebody who dies, who doesn't have children, who hasn't had, hasn't had marriage. It's all of us. All of us are going to die lives that are somehow incomplete. And we're going to say, we need to mourn that. You know, sometimes when I work with priests or sisters or religious groups who take vows of celibacy, I'll often ask them, have you ever mourned your celibacy? Or some years ago, I went to a retreat given by an incredible young woman who's married to a Presbyterian minister, and she couldn't have children, and she does retreats on barrenness. And women came, not many men, and the whole purpose of the retreat is, have you ever mourned the fact that you're not going to have children? You can be very happy as a woman not having children, but you better have mourned that. One retreat, I asked these priests, I said, you ever mourned your virginity or your celibacy? And one priest said, I love that story from, he says, to go to the 40 days in the desert, he said, because Vegas is a desert. He says, I want to go to Las Vegas for 40 days and bewail my celibacy. Okay. See, there's a virginity, there's a celibacy, there's an inconsummation in all of us. Okay, we're all that daughter because there's a part in our soul, like Mother, like Thérèse of Lisieux, like Simone Weil, that it can't be touched. You can have kids, you can have a great sexual relationship, have a good spouse, you can have family, religion, and there'll still be some part of you that's not touched. Okay, that's the part we want to nail down. That's the part for moral loneliness. Now, before I want to define moral loneliness, explain it, I want to say where it comes from. Because where it comes from, it's going to be its explanation. See, why is this inside of us? Does Augustine's caption, where Augustine said, "You've made us for yourself, Lord, and our hearts are restless until they rest in you," does that get it? Partially. Partially he gets it, partially there's still something missing. Or more classically in Christianity, and those of you come from Protestant traditions, particularly in Protestant traditions, but also in Roman Catholicism, we blamed it on sin. So you know the reason we aren't perfectly happy in this life? It's because of sin, and so on. There's some flaw in our makeup. No. Where does this come from? I'm going to give you some images. The great philosopher, theologian of the tail end of the last century, the Jesuit Bernard Lonergan, one of the great intellectuals of the last century. And Bernard Lonergan says, "So you know, you don't come into this world as they used to call a tabula rasa. See, when you're born, it's if you're not born into this world and your soul is this blank piece of paper, white photographic paper on which you stamp anything. So you're not born as a piece of paper, blank. He said, you're born this way. He says, you are born with the first principles branded into your soul. That's quite an expression. I'll tease it out. He said, you're born with the first principles. God has branded the first principles into your soul. What are the first principles? There's four of them. We say, all reality, but particularly God said, God is one, true, good, and beautiful. Oneness, wholeness, truth, goodness, and beauty. And Lonergan says, when you're born, God has branded these into your soul. So you're born and beauty and truth, goodness, love, wholeness, they're stamped in your soul like a cow that's been branded. And so your whole life, you know them in a perfect form because they exist perfectly in God. Inside of God, there is perfect wholeness, there's perfect truth, there's perfect goodness, there's perfect beauty, and you were once there. That's where you came from. So those things are inside of you. So you go through your whole life, you've already known perfect beauty, perfect goodness, perfect truth, perfect wholeness, and you don't quite meet it here. No matter how wonderful the people you are that you live with and so on, they aren't God. Nothing's perfect, but you know perfection. It's inside of you. You know, and that's why great learning is never new input. Great learning is waking up to what you already know. So you don't have to be taught what beauty is, you recognize beauty. You don't have to be taught what goodness is, you recognize it. You don't have to be taught what love is, you recognize it because you've already experienced perfect love in your life. That's Lonergan, the brand of the principles, the first principles inside of our soul. Now, that's a philosopher speaking. I want to give you some other images. The mystics. The mystics simply had a much simpler image for this. So the mystics said, you are born, and you, before you're born, and this is a beautiful mystical image, they say, the last thing that God does to a human soul, and that before God puts the soul into the body, is that God kisses the soul. So God kisses your soul, and then during your whole life, you unconsciously remember that kiss. You were once kissed by God. And so you go through your whole life, and you unconsciously remember that kiss, and you measure every kiss in your whole life against that kiss. You measure all love against that. You've already known it perfectly. See, so you, God has kissed the soul, you remember the kiss. It's interesting, the Stoics, who were mystics, the Greek Stoics, they did a number of interesting things with that. So Plato, Plotinus, they came out of that school. And the Stoics believed that your soul pre-existed with God. See, so God was perfect goodness, truth, love, beauty, and your soul was once there, and it's like a little chip of fire. So it comes from God, and it goes into your body, and then during your whole life, you somehow unconsciously remember that you were with God, and that's why in this life, nothing ever satisfies you. See, you once had everything in perfection. You once knew perfect love, perfect truth, perfect beauty, and you meet it here in this life, but never perfect. See, and plus that fire always wants to go back to the great fire in the sky, and so on. Now, what the Stoics said is, what God does is just before God puts the soul into the body, God blots out your memory. So you can't remember your past with God. You can't remember your pre-existence, you know, except you dimly know it inside of you. And you know, there's some great legends about that. I want to give you one. In one set of these mystics, they say this. See, and they believe that God put the soul into the body just minutes before you're born. So they, you know, they didn't, they believe that you gestated the body, the woman did, and then just before it was born, or when the body was fully formed, God would put the soul into the body. And when God put the soul into the body, he would seal its memory. He would seal its memory against its past life. And he said, and God did it by sealing your lips. And that's why you have a cleft under your nose. See, God would seal. You can't talk about the life you once had with God. And so that's why you have a cleft under your nose. But now try this, he said. And that is why whenever you're trying to remember something, your finger unconsciously goes under your nose. You know, you're trying to think. See, you're trying to remember that time you once were with God, and you can't remember it. You know, see, you were once with God. Now, Henry Nouwen. Henry Nouwen put a wonderful image to this. Henry Nouwen called it the memory of first love. The memory of first love. And Nouwen says, you know, when you fall in love here, it's not the first time you've known love. That's second love. He said, we come into this world and we have an unconscious. We have a dark memory of once having been loved and caressed by hands far gentler than any hands will meet on this planet. We come into this world with a dim, unconscious, dark memory of once having been loved and caressed by hands much gentler than the hands we'll ever meet in this life. See, we have a dark memory of God. We have a dark memory of perfect love, of perfect beauty, of perfect perfection. It's unconscious. Now, I want to try to tease that out. You know, when we say something touches you, it's something, I was touched by that, or not just remarks, but you're touched by things. I was just at a seminar a couple of days ago, and the speaker asked us, actually the speaker was David Wells, who's speaking here this morning. But David Wells said, you know, he had us talk to each other in a little group. He said, what touches you? Like what spontaneously, he said, kind of gets you in your gut and so on. And the group I was with, we decided, when you see helplessness, so for instance, you see a helpless baby, a baby can't feed itself, a baby can't even express his needs, you're just touched by this helplessness, this vulnerability, you know, where you see it in anybody. The poor guy who can't get a job and he's humiliated and so on. It's just, see, whenever there's helplessness, we're deeply touched, you know. Or sometimes you even see it in animals, and I'm not being facetious. Sometimes a baby kitten that's just, it's asking for food. It can't feed itself, you know. It touches the heart. But many things. You hear things and they just touch you. A good question is, what do they touch? Well, they touch that part in you. They touched that part where you were kissed by God. They touched, as Lonergan says, the brand of the first principles inside of you. They touch, now one says, that dark memory of once having known love, everything in a perfect form. See, you've already been loved perfectly. You already know perfect beauty. You already know perfect goodness. You know what wholeness is because it's inside of you. It's there, branded in your soul. It's there as a dark memory. So when you say something touches you, it touches you there. See, that's your moral center. Your moral center isn't just your conscience that tells you what's right and wrong. What tells you what's right and wrong is part of that. It's part of that, okay? But it's much wider. It's that kiss of God that's inside of you in which you measure everything in this life. See, it touches you. Or another image is the image, I say, of the bell. Okay, you know, we have an expression, and oftentimes our language teaches us something, you know, And we have this language to say, something rings true. Have you ever wondered about the expression? Say, well, this rings true or this rings false. So ask yourself, according to what? Is there a little bell inside of us that rings or doesn't ring? Or it rings in a beautiful chime or it rings in a false way? Say, this rings true or this rings false. This is what it means, see? It either touches this center beautifully, or it touches the center in some kind of violation, and so on. See, we already have a bell inside of us, the kiss of God, the dark memory of once having been touched by God in ways that in this world we never quite get touched in such a way. Now, I want to read, because I just want to get this right. So an article I've just written on moral loneliness to say, what is, now, I want to define, what is moral loneliness? Okay, let me just read this. Within each of us, at a place where all that is most precious within us takes its root, there's a dark, inchoate sense of once having been touched, caressed, loved, and valued in a way that is beyond anything we have ever consciously experienced. In fact, all the goodness, love, value, and tenderness we experience in this life falls short, precisely because we already know something deeper. When we feel frustrated, angry, betrayed, violated, or enraged, it is in fact because our outside experience is so different from what we already hold dear. We all have a place. We all have this place, a place in the heart, where we hold all that is most precious and sacred to us. And from that place, our own kisses issue forth, as do our tears. It is the place we most guard from others, and yet is the place we would most want others to come into. It's the place where we're most deeply alone, and it's the place of intimacy, the place of innocence, and the place where we get violated. It's the place of compassion, and it's the place of rage. It's the place of the holy. We are temples of God, sacred churches of truth and love, and it is there that we bear God's image. So this must be properly understood. The image of God inside of us is not to be thought of as some beautiful icon that is stamped inside the soul. Rather, the image of God in us is energy, fire, memory, especially the memory of a touch so tender and loving that its goodness and truth become the energy and prism through which we see everything. That's what I just said. See, now we have an unconscious memory of once having been caressed and loved perfectly by God. That becomes the prism through which we see everything. Thus, we recognize goodness and truth outside of ourselves precisely because they resonate with everything that is already inside of us. See, when we see beauty, we know beauty. It's already inside of us. Things touch our hearts. And when they touch us here, it's because we have already been touched and caressed. And it's because of this that we seek for a soulmate, for someone to join us in this tender space. Now, finally, and we measure everything in our lives by how it touches this place. Why do certain experiences touch us so deeply? Do not our hearts burn within us in the presence of any truth, love, goodness, or tenderness that's genuine and deep? Why do our eyes fill with tears in the presence of tenderness and beauty? Is not all knowledge simply a waking up to something we already know? Is not all love simply a question of being respected for something we already are? And are not the touch and tenderness that bring ecstasy nothing other than a stirring of deep memory? Are not the ideals that inspire hope only the reminder of words somebody has already spoken to us? Does not our desire for innocence, and innocence means to be not wounded, mirrors some primal unwounded place deep inside of us? And when we feel violated, is it not because someone has irreverently entered the sacred inside of us? We have the sacred inside of us. That's the place of, It's the deepest place inside of us, the place where everything that's most precious to us is. It's the place we most deeply want somebody to come there, but it's the place we most protect, you know, because if somebody doesn't come there with proper respect, we're violated. That is moral loneliness. And actually, it's no accident that you see it in such a pronounced way in great people, in Thérèse of Lisieux, in Simone Weil, or if you ever read the full life of Dag Hammarskjöld, used to be the Secretary General. His life is simply, there's been a huge new book written to him by Walter Lipsky, which I much recommend, just Dag Hammarskjöld, one of the great moral figures of the last century. And in them, you see this, they're people of this powerful integrity because they know that touch. And for them, truth, beauty, goodness, love, they fight for it in its best sense. Now, finally, what do we do with that? That's moral loneliness. And to the extent that we are sensitive to our own souls, we know it. See, and I said today it's often expressed. Today it takes a popular expression in all those books where people are seeking for their soulmate. People are looking for a soulmate. What's a soulmate? Well, it's a soulmate is somebody who would meet you there. Notice that somebody, that's something that's deeper than being somebody's lover. You know, somebody who meets you in your soul. The soulmate. Okay. Now, what do we do with that? Well, we can spend our lives looking for someone to meet us there. And perhaps like Simone Weil, we and Thérèse of Lisieux and Dag Hammarskjöld, we might never find anybody. You know, or if we're lucky, we find a moral companion who can meet us there. We're all exiles of the heart. You know, the great French philosopher, anthropologist René Girard, he coined an expression which I much like, and he was replying it to Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane. He said, Jesus' loneliness in the Garden of Gethsemane, he said, Jesus was unanimity minus one. Not like that. Unanimity minus one. There's the whole world, and there's you. Okay. And that kind of loneliness, it's not, do you have friends in your life? Do you have children? Do you have a spouse? Do you have a parish community? Those things are needed. But in the end, there's something else. How do you fill that in? Okay. Well, remember I said it's not met necessarily by sleeping with somebody, except I want to suggest something different. It's met by sleeping with each other inside the Holy Spirit. It's quite an expression. We need to sleep with each other inside the Holy Spirit. Now, what's in that expression? What is the Holy Spirit? Okay. Remember, a friend of mine said he went to an elementary classroom trying to prepare kids for confirmation. And he said, what is the Holy Spirit? And one little girl said, I don't know, but it's something to do with a bird. Okay. My favorite definition or image of the Holy Spirit is given by St. Paul in Galatians at the end of chapter 5, where Paul says, I'm going to tell you what the Holy Spirit is. But first he said, I'm going to tell you what the Holy Spirit isn't. Just so you know, like, we first get the uncola before we get the cola, okay? And he said, this is what the Holy Spirit isn't. He said, when we are into gossip, factionalism, envy, enmity, slander, licentiousness, drunkenness, and he said, the party spirit, and the party spirit is factionalism, the party spirit of the Republicans and the Democrats and pro-life and pro-choice and this, and I'm this, you know, he said, that's not the Holy Spirit, that's divisive. Notice, nobody's sleeping with anybody, okay? Or if they are, they shouldn't be, okay? Then he says, this is the Holy Spirit, the famous 12 fruits of the Holy Spirit. He said, the Holy Spirit is charity, joy, peace, patience, goodness, long-suffering, constancy, mildness, and chastity. See, when we are together in community with anybody, you know, in charity, joy, peace, patience, goodness, long-suffering, mildness, constancy, and chastity, we are touching each other at that deep place. Because that is the brand of the first principles inside of us. That's where we meet each other. That's where your true soulmate lies. Because the soul is branded with these. That's what doesn't violate us. That's what brings somebody into that space to fill in that space. You know, we need to sleep in the Holy Spirit. Charity, joy, peace, patience, goodness, long-suffering, mildness, constancy, and chastity. I want to end, I want to read you a poem, which you all know, and actually I named the book after it, The Holy Longing. But this poem by Goethe takes an interesting turn at the end. Let me read this poem. It says, tell a wise person or keep silent, because the mass man, the population, will mock it right away. He said, I praise what is truly alive, what longs to be burnt to death. In the calm water of the love nights, where you were begotten and where you have begotten, a strange feeling comes over you when you see the silent candle burning. Now you are no longer caught in the obsession with darkness, and a desire for a higher love-making sweeps you upward. Notice what he's saying. He says, a desire for a higher love-making sweeps you upward. Distance does not make you falter now, but arriving in magic, flying, and finally insane for the light, you are a butterfly and you are gone. As long as you haven't experienced this, to die and so to grow, you are still only a troubled guest on a dark planet. A desire for a higher life, love making sweeps you upward, he said, and then you become insane for the light. That is the meaning of moral loneliness inside of us. I think it's very, very important that we touch this inside of us. First of all, for our self-understanding, you know, to understand yourself. Like, I remember being helped as a young seminarian by reading the works of Sidney Callahan, the ethicist from New York. So I'm this 19, 20-year-old seminarian, you know, hormonally jumping out of my skin and being really restless. And I remember reading Sidney Callahan one day. He says, you know, if you find yourself just like pathologically restless and you can never sit still and you might fear that you're oversexed or whatever, she said, good. She said, you're emotionally healthy. You know, you don't need any drugs to, you know, see, that's the feeling of being a human being. And the more sensitive you are, the more you're more likely to feel your moral loneliness, which is this deep call. That's also a deep center of our faith. You know, God doesn't hit us on the head with hammers. And God normally doesn't shout through microphones the way the man is shouting outside this arena. Okay. God is, you know, God is lies like a little baby. That's the way God was born in this world, waiting to be picked up, a voice that you can ignore, but it never goes away. And that voice is the deep principles that are branded inside of our soul. That is moral loneliness inside of us. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Father Rolheiser, for this workshop. One announcement, we need the help of all ministers of Holy Communion to assist in the distribution of communion at the arena liturgies. Please sign up at the Ministers of Holy Communion table located in front of the sacristy, that is just outside the west entrance to the arena. Thank you very much for your help. And please remember to evaluate this workshop and all other workshops. It helps us a lot. Thank you.
Christ has no body now but yours, no hands but yours here on this earth. Yours is the work to serve with the joy of compassion. No hands but yours to heal the wounded world. No hands but yours to soothe all suffering. No touch but yours to bind the broken hope of the people of God. Christ has no body now but yours. No hands but yours. Joy of compassion. No eyes but yours to see as Christ would see, to find the lost, to gaze with compassion. No eyes but yours to glimpse the holy joy of the city of God. Christ has no body now but yours, no hands but yours, here on this earth. Yours is the work to serve with the joy of compassion.
Two or three of our adjustments. In the walking on the road, we saw him. In the telling of our hopes, we saw him. In the burning of our hearts, we saw the Lord. At the meal he took the bread, and then he blessed it, broke it, offered it. In the breaking of the bread, suddenly our eyes were open, and we knew he was alive.
We set out to find his friends, to tell them everyone that we could meet, to tell them. And with joy we told them, we have seen the Lord. And as we were speaking there, he stood among us, blessed us, said to us, now my peace I leave with you. We saw him, suddenly our eyes were open, and we knew he was alive.
Stayed without him, waiting for the one he said that he would send. Oh, then the Spirit of the Lord came down upon us, filling us, changing us, giving us the strength to say, we saw him, suddenly our eyes were open, and we knew he was alive.
We ran out into the street, tell them, everyone that we could meet,
Hello, if you're just joining us, we are live from Anaheim, California at the 2016 Los Angeles Religious Education Congress, celebrating the theme of Boundless Mercy. Si apenas ha sintonizado nuestra transmisión en vivo de este Congreso 2016 de Los Ángeles de Educación Religiosa, gracias por su sintonía. Estamos a punto de comenzar el evento de apertura. We are about to begin the opening event. Everyone is gathered. There are dancers, musicians from throughout the Los Angeles Archdiocese that for the very first time are going to be processing in from the various corners of the arena. Es la primera vez que los músicos y los danzantes de las distintas regiones de Los Ángeles y del país van a procesar hacia el altar para este evento de apertura. Gracias por su sintonía. Soy Alex Venegas. I'm Alex Venegas. I'll be your host and commentator. Thank you. That was Tiana Falls from the St. Paul Assyrian Church of the East here in Anaheim, California, proclaiming the Lord's Prayer in Aramaic. Aramaic being the language that is purported to be spoken by Jesus during his time. We are preparing for the opening ceremony procession. We are hearing a call to worship. The drums are the heartbeat of the church, the heartbeat of a people. And we are being convoked to praise and worship our God. Esta es una llamada a la oración. Ese toque percusivo es semblanza del corazón palpitante del pueblo de Dios que se reúne para orar. That is Valimar Jansen, one of the cantors for the Congress, convoking the church with Every Praise, a 2013 song by Jezekiah Walker and John David Branton. Esa es Valimar Jansen, la cantora para el fin de semana, convocando a la Iglesia Universal a rendir toda alabanza y adoración con esta canción de Jezekiah Walker y John David Branton. For the first time in the history of the Congress, we have the various musicians processing in. This is a testament to the fact that the musicians are part of the assembly and they're processing in from the people of God. Por primera vez en la historia del Congreso, sus 60 años, los músicos están procesando desde los distintos puntos de la arena, en simbolizando que vienen y emanan desde el pueblo, la grey del Señor. Seeing the various cultures of the Archdiocese of Los Angeles represented in the various dancers that are processing in, singing Every Praises to our God. Minutes ago, we just saw Bishop Jose Gomez and Father Chris Bezuros, the new director of religious education for the Archdiocese. He will be the keynote speaker for today's opening ceremony. Estamos observando las distintas etnias y culturas de la diócesis representadas en los danzantes, en las familias que procesan. Hace unos minutos vimos a Monseñor José Gómez, arzobispo de Los Ángeles, y al Padre Chris Bezuros, que es el nuevo director de educación religiosa para la diócesis. Será el ponente principal.
With one. every word of worship with one accord.
Toda alabanza al Señor.
Every word of worship with one accord.
Hân hoan giáng mừng khen danh Cha.
Every word of worship.
This is a litany that is part of the opening song, Every Praise, and we've just heard invocations in Spanish, Vietnamese, and Tagalog. Again, a true testament of the multicultural, multi-ethnic nature of the church. Acabamos de escuchar letanías en español, vietnamita y Tagalog, representando las distintas culturas de la diócesis.
Lord Jesus Christ, you have taught us to be merciful like the Heavenly Father. You have told us that whoever sees you sees him. Show us your face, and we shall be saved. During this year of grace, let us hear, as if addressed to each one of us, the words you spoke to the Samaritan woman. If you knew the gift of God, send your Spirit and consecrate every one of us with his anointing. Let the church be your visible face in the world, an instrument of your peace. You will that your ministers will also be clothed in weakness in order that they may feel compassion for those in ignorance and error. Let everyone who approaches them feel sought after, loved, and forgiven by God. We ask this of you, Lord Jesus, through the intercession of Mary, Mother of Mercy, you who live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit forever. Amen. Amen.
That was opening prayer by Bishop Jose Gomez, Archbishop of the Archdiocese of Los Angeles.
Padre, he fallado contra ti.
Father, I have failed and I have sinned against
God
you.
God is approaching. God is coming near to us.
What should we expect?
When you come near me, I hesitate. I shrink back.
You approach me with your weapon drawn, armored, eyes hidden.
You come when you want me, on fire. I am suspicious and defensive.
I clench my fists around my possessions and my life. I'm afraid of you.
So I'll join with you. We can get what we want.
We can take it from the weak.
We'll build a wall, guard the borders, and pass laws around what we take to protect it.
God is drawing near. God, who is life. God, who has nothing to do with death. God is approaching. Nothing. No one is like God. God has no rivals.
God will be like us. God made us like him, so God must want what we want. God must be rich and powerful.
Like us, yes. Jealous, vengeful, moody, miserable.
We get to decide what God likes. We decide what is good. And by doing that, we please God.
So we ask God to crush our enemies, those who are not like us, people who want what we have, who don't do the things that we say are good.
People who don't obey and worship, speak, dress, and act like we do.
God is approaching. God is drawing near.
What will God say to us?
What will God do to us?
What will God do to our enemies?
A voice speaks God's own name, mercy. God reveals a face.
It is the face of another human being.
It is the face of every other human being.
It is the face of Jesus Christ, who is hungry, who is thirsty,
who is in prison, who is sick,
who is naked,
who sleeps in a stable,
who welcomes friends, rivals, and enemies to the table,
who heals the sick, restores the castaway to community,
who calls God our Father,
who says that sins are already forgiven, who gives us a new start,
who says that God wants mercy, not sacrifice,
whose commandment is love one another.
And we killed him.
We killed him because we wanted the walls and the weapons.
We wanted the power of saying who's good and what's evil.
We wanted to control of God and everything and everybody else.
But God is approaching, drawing near in the risen Jesus,
whose word, after we killed him, is not revenge, but
shalom.
Who gives his life, his own life breathing to us who are afraid to breathe.
Receive the holy breath.
Who invites us to share the mission of mercy.
Be merciful as your Father is merciful.
A mission of service.
As the Father sent me, so I send you.
A mission of solidarity.
Love God. Love your neighbor like yourself. Love your enemies. God is approaching from everywhere, every time, all time.
Come near us, not like the gods we invented.
Not like the gods of retribution, violent and gluttonous.
Not like our national gods, preening, boastful, arrogant, demanding.
God draws near, bowing in service, strewing divine life across the universe, full of boundless mercy.
God draws near from within the eyes and heart of every friend, enemy, and stranger who approaches us.
God is drawing near.
Let us take these days to run towards the mercy that God offers, to leave behind the false gods of our own making.
Let us be merciful as God is merciful. Let us draw near to one another.
Let us be mercy.
Let us be mercy. Mercy.
That was a four-person proclamation of opposites in the world today, a juxtaposition of the headlines that we hear every day in newspapers and throughout media, and a call to mercy. And it is a reflection that compels us to think of the times when we are not merciful. Esa fue una presentación por cuatro oradores de los opuestos en el mundo de hoy, la juxtaposición de la misericordia que nos convoca el Papa Francisco y las líneas que vemos todos los días, las estadísticas.
Day and night, this grace I can't comprehend, a love that has no end. When storms arise, you are near. When danger comes, who shall fear? You enfold me in your embrace. The vision of your face no dream could ever replace.
Was Boundless Love by Nguyen Van Thanh, translated into English by Brother Rufino Zaragoza, sung by Linda Nguyen from Mount St. Mary's College in Brentwood, California.
Me fui de tu lado y hoy derrotado regreso a ti.
I left your side and now, completely defeated, I come back to you.
A reading from the book of the prophet Hosea. When Israel was a child, I loved him. Out of Egypt I called my son. The more I called them, the farther they went from me. Yet it was I who taught Ephraim to walk, who took them in my arms, but they did not know that I cared for them. I drew them with human cords, with bands of love. I fostered them like those
who raise an infant to their cheeks. I bent down to feed them. How could I give you up, Ephraim? Or deliver you up, Israel? My heart is overwhelmed. My pity is stirred. I will not give vent to my blazing anger, for I am God and not a man, the Holy One present among you. I will not come in wrath. They shall follow the Lord who roars like a lion, and I will resettle them in their homes. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
That was a scripture that was proclaimed in English and simultaneously in American Sign Language as a respect and homage to our deaf community here in the Church of Los Angeles. That was Amazing Grace, the traditional hymn by John Newton, as performed by Ryan Klaus, Sarah Hart, and Harrison Crenshaw, with Chris Tomlin's 2006 adaptation known as My Chains Are Gone.
Ven, hijo querido, estabas perdido.
Come, my dear son, you were lost.
We pray for those who call us to life-giving waters.
For humble leaders who reverence others in words, deeds, and actions.
For ministers who summon us to return to God with all our hearts.
For the leaders who summon the world's people to a change of heart.
For the ones who work tirelessly for lasting peace.
For prophets who lay down their lives for others.
Oh Lord.
Soldiers, pilgrims, students, missioners and aid workers, prisoners, immigrants, and refugees.
For those separated by old fears and hurts.
For the ones who return to places of welcome and forgiveness.
For the children of God, whose nights are filled with terror and the thunder of angry weapons.
For those whose needs are for the most basic necessities of life. The hungry, naked, the lonely, the homeless, and the hopeless.
For the people who yearn to return to the church, and for those who will welcome them.
Oh Lord.
Oh, Lord, 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 Lord.
vivido, ven junto a mí.
And today, repentant, you've been reborn, and you've come beside me.
Good morning, church. Buenos dias, iglesia.